late model AEV JK with a 6.0. This customer got a brand new 6.0 L96 engine. GM is keeping the L96 in production for the new heavy-duty trucks, so you can still get them new in a crate, and it really runs good. This Jeep is using all of our new kit components, including the easy engine mounts. They really help, especially if you're not going to pull the body. There's no fabrication required to install the engine, and they're adjustable. We're also running the billet brackets on this Jeep. The billet brackets refine this swap to the way it should be. You can run the GM drive, but there are some compromises, there are some interferences. The billet brackets really finish it off. They put the accessories where they're supposed to be. They reuse the factory harnesses and hoses. Plus, they look awesome. This Jeep is running our new easy harness with plug and play power distribution center. The 6.0 L96 is an evolution of the LY6. They added flex fuel to it in 2010. It's pretty much been the standard gas motor in the heavy duty trucks. So if you didn't get a diesel, you usually got some variant of the 6-liter heavy duty truck motor. There was an LC8 version of this engine that was multiple fuels. You could use propane or natural gas as well as gasoline and alcohol. There is the LY6, which is the earlier version of the 6-liter Gen 4 engine, which did not have flex fuel. Otherwise, it's pretty much identical to this engine. So they've run the L96 from about 2010 right up to the current day. This L96 has a lot of torque. It's not as powerful as the LS3 on the top. You can do some tuning on these 6-liters and get 350 to 375 horsepower easily out of them. A lot of guys ask me, how docile is the LS3? And I can only say it's about as docile as a stock engine. It idles really low, really solid. There is no rump, rump, rump. There is no hydrocarbons blowing out the tailpipe. It's just a really docile engine. When you get on it, it turns into the Mr. Hyde engine. It has about 450 horsepower in the 430 horse tune. Now, there is a 480 and a 525 horse LS3, and a lot of guys ask me about those, but in my opinion, I would stay with a 430, and there's several reasons for that. 430 is a more docile engine. If you go with a 480 or a 525 engine, what you're going to get is more top-end power. Now, I'm going to give it some throttle here. You're going to see a downshift, because we're literally at 1,500 RPM on the freeway. And then accelerate out with these. As soon as I let off the throttle a little, those R's come right back down. We're at 65 at 1,500 RPM. And you do want to gear these LSs tall. They like tall gears. The 6L80 has a 4-to-1 low first gear, so it'll still launch your heavy JK out of the hole with no problem. But as you can see right now, I'm cruising over 60 miles an hour up the parkway at 1,500 RPM. A stock V6 would probably be turning 3,000 RPM right now. Getting back to the 480 and the 525 horse, they're great motors. They're basically LS3s with cams in them. I do believe recently GM just started changing the valve springs and beefing up the top end for more horsepower. However, you're still stuck with a hot rod engine. You get that rump, 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 rough idle. And if you like that, that's great. But if you want something that's docile, that'll crawl all day, run cool, get the LS3 430. You can always upgrade the LS3 430. The LS3 430 is about the most supported engine right now in the aftermarket. Anything you want, blowers, cams, intakes, valve covers, is available for the LS3. When you dyno these things, you're going to have a 450 horsepower engine, but you're probably only going to be putting out somewhere between 350 and 400 rear wheel horsepower. Most likely not 400, and a lot of that depends on your drivetrain losses. If you have an Atlas 4-speed, 40-inch tires, there's a lot of drive lane drivetrain loss. It can be as much as 100 horsepower. So keep that in mind. You want to try to stay with some light tires and keep your JK as light as you can. I know Expedition JKs are heavy, but if you can lighten things up by eliminating components you don't need. The reality now is that we're going to be moving on to the Gen 5 engines. The LS3 is getting to be older technology. It's been out now for quite a few years. And while it's a great motor, unfortunately technology moves on. We're doing a lot of the Gen 5 engines now, the 5.3, L83, the 6.2, L86, even the LT1s, and hopefully the LT4 soon. The Gen 5 motors, as you all know, have continuous variable valve timing, direct fuel injection, high compression. These Gen 5 motors are putting out a tremendous amount of torque. In fact, we're finding that these engines are very limited by the tune, because if they weren't, they would start breaking parts. You got basically a diesel-like engine, 11.5 to 1 compression with continuous variable valve timing, so you can control cylinder pressure. These engines are capable of a lot of torque, and torque is what moves your JK. And these engines are idling at 500 to 600 RPM, but putting out similar, if not more, horsepower than the Generation 4 crate motors with perfect drivability. Now, if you were to take an LS3 or a 6.0 and cam it, and you had that rump, rump, rump idle, you're going to get similar performance, but you're losing the drivability. So that's what the Gen 5 motors are going to offer us. They're going to offer us the drivability of a stock engine with the horsepower of the high horsepower crate engines from the last generation. It really is exciting, although I do feel that we are reaching the law of diminishing returns as far as economy goes. Physics state that it takes X amount of energy to move X amount of weight. Now, you can do it more efficiently, but you're never going to overcome physics. I'm in a 5 or 6,000 pound JK, probably more right now, going up an incline, and it's going to take X amount of energy to get me up that hill. If I had a 1977 small block Chevy versus what I have now, I'm going to get much worse mileage. This LS3 is a relatively efficient engine. It's going to get pretty decent mileage, but I can't overcome physics. It's going to require X amount of gas. So I'm not going to get 25 miles to the gallon in this JK with this combination. Now, would I hope to get mid-teens? Yes, I would. And a lot of that depends on the gearing also. I'm not sure what gears are in this JK, but they're pretty tall. Now, if you look at a lot of these JKs, including this one, you got all sorts of stuff hanging off of it. We got what appears to be a luggage rack or boat on the roof, rock rails, a lift which reduces aerodynamic performance, winches, and all this comes down to aerodynamic drag. You're going to geometrically decrease your fuel economy the faster you go with all this drag. So don't have unrealistic expectations and expect to take a very heavy JK with a lot of drag and get 20 miles to the gallon. It's just not going to happen. So keep your expectations realistic. I think we have a lot coming down the pipe, not only the Gen 5 motors, but we're looking at some diesels, and one of the battles we're fighting right now is emissions. Emissions is becoming more and more of an issue around the country. Unfortunately, there's a misconception not only by the public but by the authorities how emissions work. There's just way too much ambiguity right now in how these V8s are going to be integrated into the system. The reality is these V8s are going to continue to be put into JKs. The lawmakers need to work with us. And I think the lawmakers are trying to make efforts towards that. But enforcement, unfortunately, is very immature. It really depends on where you're at in the country. Some areas have no inspection and no enforcement. Other areas are overbearing with enforcement, and they hire uneducated, or they have uneducated systems of inspectors that don't understand what an engine conversion is. I've been an emissions inspector for about 20 years, and I worked in California, and I work here in Vegas, and I work with a lab here very closely. And unfortunately, there's a lot of ambiguity and interpretation in an engine swap. So they can't make a bullet point checklist, this is what you were going to do. Now, there are bullet point checklists, this is what you're going to do. But unfortunately, it comes down to interpretation. This is a battle that we are fighting right now. And one of the main points of integrating a diesel into a JK for us is to keep it legal. Now, the new Cummins engine looks like a great engine, but unfortunately, Cummins was not able to get it certified for later model OBD2 vehicles. They may get it certified for the first generation OBD2 vehicles. I don't think they have yet. They might. But it's very unlikely they're going to get it certified for CAN interfaced OBD2 vehicles or enhanced OBD2, which would include the JK. So what we're doing is we're going down the other road, which is going to be to use a US EPA certified North American light duty diesel. By putting that into a JK, hopefully we can keep it compliant in most areas of the country. So what we're seeing is a lot of technology coming together in the Gen 5 engines, and it's for the advantage of the JK. The fact that GM can continue to manufacture these large displacement engines means we can put them in vehicles. We're not stuck like the Europeans with small 2-3 liter motors that are very peaky and turbos and small displacement diesels. We have the American V8 still available to us. And by using these advanced technologies like direct injection, we're keeping these engines clean, which allows us to put them into these JKs. The Gen 5 motors actually lend themselves perfectly to the JK. Maybe in some ways better than the Gen 4 motors, because the Gen 5 motors are really all about torque and efficiency. And a heavy vehicle needs torque and efficiency. It's just like a truck. And that's what these JKs need. So does this mean the Gen 4 motor is obsolete? No, by no means it's not. And in the early JKs, it still makes a great swap. But it does mean as we go into the future, we're going to be integrating more and more of the new technology into our swap. Who knows what we're going to see? 8-speed transmissions, 10-speed transmissions. I've even heard rumors of overhead cam engines. We're using our billet drive brackets, and I know I mentioned that in every video, but let me tell you, they have really taken a lot of the load off of the swap. Not having to run a GM accessories, modify things, and running custom lines and such has really streamlined it. Plus, the billet brackets look awesome. And then when you look at our easy engine mounts that are bolt-in, they've taken a chunk of labor out of the swap. Being able to drop your motor into the frame with no modifications means now you can more efficiently do the swap with the body on. I'm calling this a reversible swap because literally you could take the V8 out and put your V6 back in if you wanted to. Properly taken care of, this engine can go 300,000 miles. On this 2012 and plus build, to use our billet brackets, you do need to change the accessories out to the early JK. They're not very expensive. There are high quality replacements for Mopar components. I do recommend, whether you have an early JK or a late JK, that you go with a Mopar power steering pump if you're going to stay with a stock pump. We've tried the aftermarket pumps and they just don't work. Now if you go with a PSC, Howe Racing, AGR, those are good pumps. But don't go with a cheap branded pump. You're just going to get whining and leaking. There's a lot of good choices out there for the alternator and the air compressor now. You don't have to go with Mopar. The longevity of an air compressor is really dependent on the system being set up properly. What I mean by that is AC condenser pressure is about 1-to-1 with temperature. So if you have 200 PSI pressure, you have 200 degrees temperature in the condenser. The condenser is what moves the heat out of the air conditioning system. So if your fan, let's say, were not powerful enough, or you had a winch blocking airflow and the condenser got really hot, the pressure is going to get high. That high pressure is going to put more stress and load on the compressor and the belt system. So if you have belt failures or you have compressor failures, don't just automatically say, I've got a bad compressor. You may want to look further and see what caused that compressor to go bad, because a properly designed compressor should last for virtually the life of the vehicle. So that's pretty much it on the Pentastar build.